So CAN stand for controller area network. So what it means is, if you see in any of the automotive issues, in any of the automotive communication which takes between place between the multiple issues, we are now moving towards CAN, and most of the even the Indian vehicles are now coming from the UART based network or from other network to CAN based protocol. Not only in this automotive industry, but if you see into the industrial use also, where the communication is required, we are using the CAN network. So the first point is the CAN is serial based communication. So obviously, if you see into any of the communication, which is from one issue to other issue, whether it would be SPI, I2C, or UART, they all are serial communication. The same way, CAN is also a serial communication protocol. Serial communication means like we do not have, if we want to send 1 byte of data, it will be transmitted through one pin only or one or two pins only. If it's in parallel communication, at one point of time, we have many lines to transmit the data. The second thing is CAN is a robust communication protocol. So what do we mean by robust is, when we transmit any data in CAN frame, generally whatever issues we develop a real-time operating based system issues. So if any problem comes, immediately it will be informed to the other issues. So in our vehicle electronics, we are having many issues. So there can be ABS, there can be something regarding to the infotainment, there can be something regarding to the to a door to anything door control thing. So we see it like the ABS. If any message is coming from the ABS, that is on the very high priority. So for that, we need a network. We need a communication network where we can actually put up the things which are more prior will be more dominant over the things which are less prior. So if you see about the CAN communication, it very much looks like to the general communication which we have between the people. So when any important person is speaking, he becomes a dominant. So you will be actually waiting for that important person to complete his talk first, and then you will speak. So the same thing is also on the CAN. And another example is the one who talks louder is getting dominated with the one who talks softer. So the engineers actually wanted to establish a communication protocol where we can actually put up the thing which mimics to the real world communication. So we'll be seeing it very quickly, how this is done on the CAN. Okay, the third point is CAN is message based, not address based. So what do we mean by message based is, if you have already worked on I2C or in RSPI, you must have seen like whenever we want to talk with some other peripherals, like you have a barometer and you have barometer I2C module, and you have a camera, you have a display I2C module. So if you and if you have connected it on the base on both, if you have connected both on the same I2C lines, you will be actually sending the address of barometer module when you are transmitting the I2C frame. If you are transmitting the address of the barometer, it will go to the barometer module, and if you are transmitting the I2C address of LCD module, it will be going to the LCD. So here what we see is the message what we are sending are address based, but this is not on on the CAN. Here the messages are here whatever what we send is message based. So we have a message identifier with the data what we are sending, and this actually says like which issues to receive, which is for the which issues, and what message does what information does this message contains. In CAN we have data rate of 1 Mbps. When we talk about the CAN protocol, here we are not here the intention is not to send huge chunks of data, like to refresh the LCD or to get a big chunk of data. Here the thing is basically to alert someone or to get some basic information, like you have if you have pressed the brakes, then a signal must go, and that will be a very short signal. It will not be of a very big chunk of data. So here the speed doesn't matter. Here the reliability matters on the CAN network when we talk about. Okay. Again, all these points will be going to see on the next slides how this CAN network does this. The second last point is carrier sense multiple access protocol with collision detection. So we'll be looking into this. I will tell about this point on the further slides, and arbitration on CAN message priority. This also I will take up in the next slide. Okay. So from the electrical perspective, how we actually connect our issues to the CAN network. So we have to put two resistors, 120 ohm, 120 ohm, on the two sides of the CAN. So if there are three issues, we'll be actually asking two issues vendor to put 120 ohm, 120 ohm resistance on the either side. If there is also a third issue, then we'll be not asking them also to put. So the overall line impedance must be 60 ohms only. Okay, so we can put up as many, we can connect as many issues to the CAN bus lines without any problem. So you can see we have two lines on the CAN. One is CAN H and one is CAN L. We do not require any VCC or ground lines for this CAN network. Okay, so I was talking about dominant and recessive when I gave you example of a dominant person, a person who speaks louder, his voice is dominant and it takes up the message of what is softer, what a person who is talking in a soft manner. So if you see in the electrical side, if you can understand a bit of the electronics over here. So you see a 5-volt high has been put on the line. And here is 3 BJTs. So if the BJT is off, so when the BJT will go on, a short will be created. Okay. So if all the BJTs is off, the line will be 5-volt. Okay. So it will be high. And if any of the BJT actually gets shorted, means if S1 gets turned on, the line will go zero. So if any of the BJTs. So what we see here, the line zero is dominant. Let me explain you again. So if no one is transmitting on the bus, so it will be 5 volts. If any of the issues has actually turned down, it has turned up this BJT, the line will go zero. Okay. So here what we see is the zero is a dominant bit and one is a recessive bit. So if anyone wants to transmit a signal like 0101, so okay, let's see to this example. S1 wants to transmit the information 0101, we'll be just taking up this 0101, again 0101, this manner. S2 transmit two zeros with 110011, and S3 transmit continuous four zeros and continuous 41. So what we see is whenever S1 wants to, first what happens, or everyone transmits zero. So everyone has actually sorted the line. So the bus condition is zero. Now what happens, S1 has actually sent one, means he did not turn on the BJT, and rest both of them turned on. So the line impedance, line voltage is zero. Now at this time what S1 will see, S1 will actually see like I have transmitted one on the bus, but whenever he transmits something on the bus, he will check the bus voltage is same or not. Like whenever you speak, you actually see the what you are speaking, you are hearing it back or not. So if whatever you speak, if you did not heard it back, means someone has actually somebody else is also talking. So in the same way, when S1 transmitted 0, S2 also transmitted 0, S3 is also transmitted 0, they all see like we have actually transmitted whatever we want to transmit, that is there on the bus. But when S1 transmits 1, he actually see whatever I transmit is not there on the bus. So what he will understand is now I should be quiet because others are speaking. So you see S2 and S3 both actually are winning the arbitration. Okay, so the word arbitration means who is trying to win over the line, who is trying to put up his message on the bus. So next, what happens? S2 actually wants to transmit one on the bus, but S3 has actually transmitted zero. So S2 will again go quiet, and then S3 will take over the bus. So that way will go. Here what you see is S1 has again transmitted 0, but that will not happen when we see on the CAN line. So S1 will keep himself on the idle condition. So here the bus is 0001 because the bus is actually ORing the logic, but this will not be there on the CAN side. So
that is basically the name of the CAN message in electronic form. So if you just see over here, this is a identifier part, also known as the arbitration field. So as we just discussed, whenever you send 0 and someone else send 1, since 0 is a dominant bit, so you will be taking up the communication, you will be actually winning the arbitration. And the one who is sending the higher address will lose the arbitration. So if you win the arbitration, you will be able to send the actual data, the 8 bytes of data. So we look into the CAN identifier to this scenario in detail. So suppose we have three identifier. One is 0x780, one is 0x340, and one is 0x010. So here you see, this is the binary representation of 0x780. So 780, it can be represented by continuous 4 ones and 7 zeros. 340 can be represented by 0, 1, 1, 0, 1 and 6 zeros. And 0x010 is represented by 6 zeros, 1 and 4 zeros. So here you see when at first the first higher byte is transmitted, and since 780 is having the higher address, it's having 1. So when it tries to send 1, he actually sees the 1 is not updated because 0 being a dominant bit has taken over this one. So 780 will understand he has lost the arbitration, so he will stop sending. Here both 340 and 010 is able to put his data on the bus. In next byte, we see 340 is having 1 and 0x010 is having 0. So 1 will not be transmitted, and 0x010 will be able to win the arbitration, and consecutively it will be able to send the data. Now let's look into the message format of the CAN bus. So total you can send up to 8 bytes of data, which is 64 bits of data. In one CAN message, there can be several signals which can represent any real world quantity. So let's see scenario. In one of our CAN message 0x780, we are having 5 signals. The first signal is speed, second is RPM, third signal we have a start stop signal, fourth we have engine speed, and fifth we have coolant temperature. So in speed, we see we have to the maximum value of speed can be 400. So it will take up 9 bits. We have to actually arrange our data, our signals in this 8 bytes of CAN messages. So as per the color coding, you can see here at the topmost we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9th position we are going to use it to represent speed. The second signal RPM will be represented from 10th location to 22nd location. Looking into the third one, we have start off stop 1 bit. So we are using the bit 24th location to represent signal 3. Now for signal 4, engine temperature, we cannot use this 23. We are basically using the bits in a consecutive manner. So 25 to 34 will be for engine temperature, and the signal 5 coolant temperature we are using from 41 to 49. We can also have done it from 35 to 42, but we have 35 to 44. We can actually also use this location also. So this is how we can arrange the CAN signals in the CAN messages. So CAN messages are transmitted at one shot. So whenever you receive any CAN messages, you will be getting all the signals which are embedded into it. So this is one of the examples in we have arranged our CAN signals. So you can see as per the color coding. Okay, so there are basically two types of CAN messages. One is a standard CAN and one is extended CAN. So in a standard CAN, we can transmit up, we have 11-bit identifier, which we 11-bit identifier, the identifier which we have just discussed, and in extended CAN we have 29-bit identifier. So we have more addresses over here. So looking into the field one by one, so as we discussed, first is the arbitration field. In the last bit of the arbitration field, we have RTR. So suppose we want to receive some data from the any other issues. So we can actually put this value 0, so we will get a reply, that is a remote transmission request. Next is the ID. So ID basically shows are we using 11-bit identifier or we are using 29-bit identifier. So in case of 11-bit identifier, this ID will be 0. In 29-bit identifier, the ID will be 1. R0 is a reserve bit. Then we have DLC. DLC 0 to DLC 3. So here you can actually show how much length our data field will be. So the maximum length of data which we can transmit on the CAN, on the classic CAN, is 8 bytes. So you can represent how much bytes you want to transmit over this place. And then we have the data field where we can actually transmit the data which we have just seen here. So this will be on the data field. Then we have the CRC field. So CRC field will calculate the CRC value. It will calculate a checksum value and will be stored over here. So this field will be used to see if any error has occurred during transmission of these fields. If any CRC error, if this doesn't match to the data we have sent before, will be getting the CRC error. Then is the acknowledgement field. So whenever the sender is sending its data and the arbitration field with this DLC, if a receiver receives it correctly with the CRC value, he'll be putting up the acknowledgement. So he will be setting the dominant bit over here. So when you transmit the data, you will be sending a recessive one. When the receiver actually is able to get the data, he will be setting it as a 0. So reception is something like, if I am telling something and you are able to grasp it, you will putting a 0 over here. Then it is followed by the delimiter, which So it's the end of the acknowledgement field, and then we have the end of frame field, which shows the our frame has been completed. So similarly, you can find this bit fields over here in the 29 bit identifier also. Moving into the CAN error handling. So there are five types of CAN error. So first is the bit error. So bit error is something like the you are losing the arbitration. So whenever you are setting any zero, whenever you are setting one over here and you got zero, which can be if you lost, which can be due to losing the arbitration, you'll be having the bit error. Okay, so as you see, bit error occurs when transmitter monitors a signal different signal on the bus different from what it is sent. Next is stuff error. So stuff error occurs when a node detects six consecutive bit of same polarity between SOF and CRC field. So if you're getting any six consecutive zero or six consecutive one, it will be a stuff error. So if you want to send any data which has six consecutive zero, a bit of opposite polarity will be updated. If that is not done, you'll be having stuff error. CRC error, as we just discussed, if the data what we have sent doesn't match to the CRC we have put, we will be getting CRC error. Form error. So form error occurs when the recessive slots in the CAN message become dominant. So we have seen the recessive slot like DEL, which is delimiter of the CRC field, acknowledgement field delimiter, or the end of the frame. End of frame. So if the one over here gets zero, we will be getting form error. So that will say there is some problem with the transmission or in the packing of CAN messages. Acknowledgement error. So whenever any transmitter sends a data on the CAN, he will expect the acknowledgement to be set by the receiver. It is the same meaning is same meaning as I have spoken something and no one has actually replied, like he is able to get the data. So here if that is the case, the acknowledgement error will happen. So here we will learn about the fault confinement. So take up a scenario like you are doing a video conferencing and there are five people on your video conferencing and one is having a bad communication, bad network. So when you do the video conferencing, maybe one person will be telling like he is not able to hear you, or he may be disturbing the whole communication, and so the whole meeting can be disturbed. So the similar thing we are also taking up in the CAN network. We are looking into how we can reduce those problems. So what happens as to the errors what we have discussed, if one is getting the error due on receiving the data or transmitting the data, this REC error or RTEC error will increase accordingly. So if you are not able to transmit the data, your REC, your TEC error will increase, and if you are not able to receive the data, your REC error will increase. So if your error is less than 128, you will be on the error active. In the error active, you will be able to send the data, and you will be also able to send active error frames. So active error frame is same like I'm not able to hear you. That basically signifies. In error passive, you will be able to send the data and receive the data, but you will not be able to send active error frame. Here you will be able to see send passive error frames. If your error is more than 255, you will go into the bus off, and you cannot transmit anything on the bus. So how to get off of buses, that will be given by the customers on how to go back from the bus off to normal communication. But in general, in CAN, what we have is when it finds the bus is idle for 128 times. So this basically means is 128 into 11 recessive bit when it gets, it will be going back from bus off to normal mode. So in the next slide, here are the error CAN error confinement rules, which you can actually read, like how this TC and REC counter will increase. So this TC and REC counter, this is not to be taken up in your software, the code what you will write. This counter is already embedded in your CAN controller chip or in your CAN controller module. So discussing on to the type of error frames. So if you are on error active, this will be the error frame which you'll be sending. So it will be consecutive six zeros. So when you send consecutive six zeros, the and another node will also report the error, which will be due to this stuff error. So on this, you will be having six error flags which you will be sending. Then there can be six error echo which can be due to the other issues, and then you will be sending eight error delimiter, which will be eight recessive ones. Passive error, it's the same thing, but here you will be sending six consecutive one. So why here six consecutive one? Because we do not want to load the bus. So in the same time, it can happen in another node can send the data, because the zero will be dominated over this one. So that's the reason why in passive error recessive one are sent. So in this case, there will be six consecutive one, and then it will be followed by six error echo, we can be from the other nodes, and then we have the eight error delimiters with eight consecutive ones. In overload frames, if the node is busy and it's not able to read the data, he will be sending the overload frames. So that will be six consecutive zeros with the overload echo with the delimiter. Now we will be looking into the CAN driver coding. So you might have already done the driver. You might have already written the UART driver. So in UART driver, what we do is, first of all, we change the port setting from GPIO pin to UART pins. Similarly, when we code CAN driver, we will be changing the ports from GPIO ports to CAN driver ports. The second thing, what we do on the UART is, we set the baud rate based on the clock frequency. Here in CAN also, we are setting up the baud rate. Before to that, we also initialize the CAN RAM and the clock, which is required for which will be required for the CAN module. Next, we also put the channel, CAN channel and CAN module onto stop mode, so we can actually change these settings. So here we change the baud rate. We also change the sampling point, TSEC 1 and TSEC 2 registers. After this, there are two ways we can actually set up our receive buffers or transmit buffers. So we look into the two strategy. So in the first strategy, you see it is like a reserved seat. Like you are traveling by a train and you have reserved your positions. For example, in this picture you can see this message. Whenever a new message will come, it will check whether this message is equal to the filter that is applied or not. So here the filter is 780, but the message came is 762. So it will not pass. It will go to the second one. Here it will also see this is not the corresponding ID. And when it sees the particular ID, it will be stored into the particular buffer. So here what you see is every buffer has the has that pass filter, and every ID has the particular buffer. So and if none of the IDs match to this, that CAN message will be discarded. That CAN message maybe will be like it is not for our particular issue. So this is the first strategy. So you can see this strategy is more costly because it needs more buffer. But again, this is you can see like it is more reliable. It is easy for coders to actually get the values, and it is also okay when there are limited number of CAN messages. In the second strategy, you see there are many CAN messages which will be passed through this mask and filter. So when this mask and filter they have passed and it finds that this ID is for our issue, it will be stored into the buffer. So here you see 0x123 has been stored. So subsequently more CAN messages can be stored. When you can configure this message buffer by two ways. So or by the number of by the ways which might be given on the controller so so one can be like if any of the messages is received, you will get an interrupt. The second strategy can be like half of the buffer is filled, you will get an interrupt. And the third strategy can be like when the whole buffer is filled, you will get an interrupt. So on the interrupt, you will be actually reading the CAN messages value and will be giving it to the application. So here, so this is the two strategies. Yes, you can mix actually both the strategies when you are actually coding. So let us discuss on the filter and mask we have just talked about. So taking up an example of zero, here we have a filter. Let's just understand this basic algorithm. So here what we have, the mask of 1110 and the filter is 1010. So what happens if any of the messages come, the mask will actually tell on which all bits the filter has to be applied and which all bit filter does not needs to be applied. So here we see the three ones, the first three ones will say on this three bits you need to apply the filter, and on the last one you do not need to apply the filter. So it will go, it will pass through this filter. So there can be two CAN IDs which can be supported. So that will be 0101, and in the last ID it will not take care. So there can be 2 1011, or it can be 1010. So this can be two accepted IDs. Let's look into this once again with another example. So we have the mask as 780 and the filter as 78F. So the binary representation is four ones and seven consecutive zeros, and in and the filter is 78F 31130001000. So here we see the mask is applied to the first four digits. Rest all digits the filter does not need to take care. So this will be the CAN ID that will be accepted. Okay, sorry, this one will not be also not there, it can be X, because here it can pass. So it will be four ones and all X. So all the values with having these four ones and the X can be supported. Okay, now coming on to the next one, next example. Here, if we wish to accept only frames of ID 0, 4 zeros and 1567, the filter will be 411567 and the mask will be 1FF. So, if we wish to accept only one filter with, so here you see all the values has to be checked. So here you see all the values are 1. So any of the values coming with this filter will be accepted. So this is all from the filter and mask.
Going into the AutoSAR CAN stack,
So in AutoSAR CAN stack, we have basically three layers. So first is the MCAL layer, which you see on the red. Then we have the issue abstraction layer, which you see on the green. And with the blue color, we see the service layer. Above service layer, we have the RT. And above that, we actually write our application code. So coming onto the CAN stack, so you can see this in the CAN driver, in the MCAL layer, we have the CAN driver. In the ECU abstraction layer, we have the CAN IF. And the in above, in the service layer, we have COM, PDUR, CAN TP, CAN SM, CAN NM, and generic NM. So in CAN driver, we actually, this is more related to the microcontroller, setting up the microcontroller registers for the CAN communication and getting the actual, reading the actual CAN messages and transmitting the messages. So that is there on the MCAL side. On above, we have CAN IF. So the CAN IF basically provides an interface to the upper layers from the lower layers. So we can, in the lower layer, we can have multiple CAN drivers. And in above layer, there are multiple clients which can take the CAN messages and do the corresponding things. So CAN IF is basically a middle layer between these two. So in CAN IF, as I just told, we'll be providing an interface for the from the lower layers to the upper layers. So in the upper layer, we have the CAN TP. In CAN TP, we are basically, if we have the segmented CAN messages, if we have, why we are using CAN TP is basically the maximum length of the CAN is 8 bytes, and if you want to transmit more than 8 bytes of data, you can use something like a software protocol. So that is there on the CAN TP. So then we have the COM, which is which basically provides a signal level APIs to the application layer. From CAN IF, we basically have link from PDUR to the COM. So PDUR is a layer between the COM and CAN IF. Then CAN SM, we have the CAN State Manager, and CAN NM, CAN Network Manager. We'll be looking into this in more detail in our next lectures. So if you see on the AutoSAR, in the AutoSAR architecture, we are getting AutoSAR configurator from many of the software vendors. So we can actually configure this from a GUI window, and then we can generate the code. So you might be familiar with the DaVinci configurator or other EBIT resource or other code generators. So we'll be looking into what all configurations we do and how the structure is. So I think if you would be more able to grasp the concept if you have already worked on this tool, or if you have ever got a chance to work on this tool. But here we will look, but if you have not worked or haven't used this tool, you can just get a basic idea of what configurations we do. So here we have the CAN. So in CAN, we have two. We have CAN controller and CAN hardware objects. So in CAN controller, if you open CAN, you will get two options. One will be the CAN controller, and the other will be CAN hardware objects. So in CAN controller, this is more regarding to the MCAL configuration. Everything is, if you see in CAN, it is on the MCAL configuration, but this is more related to the baud rate. Like what baud rate you want, what is the base address of the CAN controller. So for this, you can open the data sheet and just check what is the base address. So all the registers will be directly be linked with this base address. CAN controller ID, so if you have many CAN controllers, you can just put up the which controller ID you are working on. Then we have CAN RX processing. So in CAN RX processing, you will be actually putting up whether you whenever a new CAN message is received, whether you will poll the new message or whether you want an interrupt for this. Similarly with CAN TX processing. So when you have transmitted any messages, do you want the confirmation to be polled or do you want the confirmation to be from an interrupt? Then wake up processing. Then we have the buses processing, baud rate, segment 1, segment 2, and sync jump width. So you can configure all these corresponding things. So that's there on the CAN controller. In CAN hardware objects, is basically so suppose you have the 7 IDs which you want to transmit. So you will be creating 7 containers over here. Which you want to receive 7 containers you will create, and for if you have 2 messages to be transmitted, you will create 2 containers of CAN TH. So in CAN HRH, you will be actually putting up the ID which you want to transmit and what is the filter code and filter mask. You will be also putting up whether it is a basic CAN or full CAN.